As we get to the book of Acts, we want to kind of focus in on verse 1. Amen. And we're going to read probably till about verse 6. I was thinking about doing till verse 11, but we're going to just do verse 6. We done spent a lot of time in here this morning already. And we got the Lord's Supper. Hallelujah. And I really want to spend some time on Sapphira, a little more time on Sapphira. Amen. Because they got some meat in there. And so let's talk about Acts 5:1. And we'll just read a little bit. Hallelujah. The Bible says, "But a certain man named Ananias and Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why had Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? While it remained, was it not thine? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God." And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. And great fear came on all them that heard these things. And the young men arose, wound him up, and carried him out and buried him. Father, we thank you, God, for this word. Your word is so rich. Now, we pray that you allow it to go out and accomplish the purpose for which you sent it out to do, God. Let your word be like a hammer this morning, breaking shackles and yokes and chains. Let your word be like water for the thirsty traveler in this place. Let your word be like fire shut up in our bones, God, to where we have to go out and spread it, O King. Let your word, Lord God, be like a hallelujah, it purge us with it, sanctify us with it. We pray that you do it for your grace, by your grace, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God some glory, amen. All right. So, saints, listen quickly, all right? We've been studying the book of Acts. And so last time we were here, we talked about a man by the name of Barnabas. And we talked about how Barnabas, amen, his original name was actually Joseph, or Joseph. But he was such an encourager that they changed his name. And so we just discussed last time, if you remember, five ways that Barnabas was an encourager. We talked about, number one, he was a financial encourager, meaning that he was not only a tither, but he was a giver over and above the tithe, amen, actually sold land, liquidated some funds, amen, and laid it at the apostles' feet. Barnabas was not only a financial encourager, but he was an encouragement to new Christians. If you remember, when Paul got saved, nobody wanted to be around Paul because they didn't believe that his conversion was sincere. But Barnabas took him in while everybody was keeping him out. And so Barnabas was an encouragement to new Christians. Barnabas was an encouragement to new works. Amen. He went to Antioch, a church that was completely different than his. Amen. A church, amen, that was of a different ethnicity, a different culture, amen. Probably sung different songs and did different things, and people dressed differently, amen. But it's an amazing thing when somebody can go in a different place and still discern the grace of God and encourage people and not break their spirit, amen. And that's what Barnabas was. He was an encourager in finances, new Christians, new works, amen, but also new leaders. Barnabas had set up that Antioch church, and it was blowing and going, and it was blessed. Amen. And he could have kept the esteem and the prestige and the success of that church all to himself because it was going fine. But Barnabas looked out upon the body of Christ and said, nah, we're just not going to allow, hallelujah, this church to do well, and I'll be the only leader. I want to develop new leaders, amen, lift new people up and show them, amen, not only what I say but what I do, so that when I'm gone, the church can keep on going. And so Barnabas sought out Paul, amen, and brought Paul into this church of Antioch and raised him up. And Paul began to preach and teach to the point to where Paul became a titan in the church. And it was all because of Barnabas, through the grace of Almighty God, raising Paul up. But Barnabas was also an encouragement to fallen soldiers. If you remember, John Mark had fallen. Amen. He went on a missionary trip and couldn't complete it. And Paul didn't want to take him no more. But Barnabas didn't let go of him. Barnabas didn't give up on him. Barnabas showed, amen, that we serve a God of a second chance. Amen. Hallelujah. So Barnabas was an encouragement to even our fallen soldiers, our fallen brothers and sisters. And we need to strive to be an encouragement like Barnabas in all of those ways. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Saints, listen. We pick up in verse 36 this morning, and we're going to keep on pressing. And got 3 points for you this morning. The title of this message is Ananias and Sapphira. Amen. And, you know, sometimes you can't wait to get to certain texts in the Bible. Amen. And this is one that really is just plush with meat. Hallelujah. And so we'll kind of break it up and cover it in two parts. And hopefully we can pick up next Sunday. But the 3 points as follow. Kept back part. But Peter said, and number 3, hearing these words. The 3 points are as follows. Kept back part. But Peter said, hearing these words. Amen. Well, y'all just, yeah, there they go. All right. And so that's our 3 points. Let's begin with our first point. Amen. Kept back part. The Bible says in 5:1, but a certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira his wife, sold a possession. And let's stop right there. So the Bible begins chapter 5 with the conjunction, but. Remember that this word is a word that suggests a contrast. Something contrary to, something in opposition of what was previously said. The Bible had just finished talking about Barnabas and how Barnabas encouraged the church by selling land and giving the proceeds to the apostles, laying it at the apostles' feet. He didn't want any acclaim. He didn't want any prestige. He just did it. He didn't do it for any ulterior motives. He just did it to bless the Lord and get the word out. That's our Barnabas. And after the Bible talks about Barnabas, amen, the Bible says, But a certain man named Ananias. And it's showing us, Jen, that Barnabas was great, but the opposite is coming. But something contrary to the ways of Barnabas is coming. You see? Something in opposition to what Barnabas was all about and what he was striving for. The Bible is about to give us a contrast. You see? And I'm telling you, Barnabas received so much notoriety because of what he did. We know he received notoriety, amen, because we still reading about what Barnabas did, hallelujah, some 2,000 years later. Luke put him in the Bible for what he did laying that property down. We still get excited today talking about it. Just imagine the church in his day. He received notoriety, honor, prestige, popularity. Oh, that's Barnabas. They even changed that brother's name, duh. You see? Now, for an outsider looking at that and looking at all the prestige, the honor, the notoriety, it's easy for somebody to look at that and say, I want that too. Anybody hear me up here? All right? I want to be popular like Barnabas. Now, they're not thinking about having the right heart. They're not thinking about what Barnabas did. They're thinking about what Barnabas received. All right? All right? That's where we're going here. That's where we're going. They just want what Barnabas received. But a certain man named Ananias, everything that Barnabas was, Ananias was not. You see? And the Bible tells us in verse 1 that Ananias and his wife, hallelujah, saw all the notoriety. So they did just what Barnabas did. They sold a piece of land. You see? But instead of giving the whole monies, like Barnabas did, they kept back the price. They kept back the price while pretending to give it all. And that's the difference, all right? God never asks us to give all of anything like that, monetarily. All God wants is what? What's the percentage God wants? And what's that called? That's called the tithe. That's what God is concerned with, all right? The sin is not that he didn't give it all. The sin was that he pretended to give it all. That he said he was going to give it all. That he went up there like Barnabas and laid it all like Barnabas, but it wasn't really all.
Woo!
It just looked like that on the surface. All right? You see? So a lot of people read this story and say, man, I'm confused. I don't know what Ananias did wrong. And others look at it and say, well, he didn't do anything wrong. No, he did a lot wrong, y'all. And we're going to talk about this in the first point. And listen, the first thing Ananias did, and I kind of alluded to it a little bit just now, but I want to put a name to it, and I want to just kind of talk about it a little bit. And in my prayer time this morning, God really told me, he said, listen, I want you to harp on this first thing right here, because that's something I don't want in Philadelphia. You know, some people don't see that Ananias did anything wrong. I'm about to give you a list of the sins that was involved in what Ananias did in this particular chapter. The first thing Ananias did wrong in the sight of God was something that we call a hypocrisy. He was a hypocrite. He was a hypocrite. Pastor, what's a hypocrite? Hypocrisy is when you pretend to be something that you are not. That you are not. Is when you put a mask on your face while you're a totally different person underneath. While people look at you and see you one way, but the moment you turn from them, your face changes. You ever caught somebody that like that? When they didn't know you was looking at them, but you're looking at them? And they got a different expression on their face. And those of us with discernment, we could look at that and we could say, that's a whole different person. They was like this in my face, but when they turned, the grimace changed. It's like I only saw one half. But there was a whole nother half on the other side. You see? That's what Ananias was. He was a hypocrite. You see? Pretending to give it all while not giving it all. They wanted to appear to men one way while they were something altogether different. It's a mask. And listen, God doesn't like hypocrisy. He never did. You see, he sees right through it. You know? Now listen, this is supposed to be convicting because I'm going to tell you the truth. Even those that don't think they're hypocrites in here, we all got a little hypocrisy in us. Every single one of us have a perception that we want everybody to see. That is different than what's in private. The question is, how different? You see? And we don't mind a little difference. Because we don't want you to do everything that you do at home out in public. We don't want to know you like that. But it can't be too much of a difference. You know what I'm saying? Where you come here doing this and, you know, getting up, wanting to pray, wanting to preach, but you beating your wife at home. You preaching on holiness and this and that, and you sleeping around town and doing everything. You see, the difference is large. It's called hypocrisy. A hypocrite. And God wants me to talk about it because all the rest of the sins that I deal with in this point one actually comes out of this root of hypocrisy. Hypocrisy never shows up by itself. It always has some attaching sins to it. And we're going to talk about that. But we know that God has a particular hatred towards hypocrisy. In Matthew 23:27, we can see his hatred of hypocrisy because of what happens in this story. But even when our Lord was walking the planet, remember that? Amen? How he would deal with hypocrisy, he would look at the religious leaders. And listen, there's very few places in the world that you can find a high concentration of hypocrisy like you can find it in the church. Like you can find it in the church. I'm being real now. Probably the only place that you can come close and find hypocrisy like in the church is in politics. That's about it. That's about it. That election stuff, all that, that's about it. That's mask. All right? And so Jesus in 23:27, look what he told him. He says, woe unto you, scribes, Pharisees. Look what he called them, hypocrites. For you are like unto whited sepulchres. You look like tombstones, white and pretty on the outside, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness. Even so, you also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within you are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. And that's what God can't stand. That's what God can't stand. That you're going to be something at home, but you're going to act the very opposite in public. All right? You know? That's what God can't stand. It's a hypocrite. God would rather you be real. Because the very ones that was the most sinful was the most hardest on sinners. Y'all feel where I'm coming from? They were sinning at home, the Pharisees, and doing wrong and on the inside messed up, but looking at the harlots and the prostitutes and judging them and being this. You see, the depths of hypocrisy. You see? In Matthew 15:7-9, he says, ye hypocrites. 15:7, he says, ye hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, this people draw nigh unto me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain do they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Philly, listen. I know a lot of you come from churches where hypocrisy was the rule of law. Meaning that you went to churches, amen, where the better you could play church, the higher you would rise on the totem pole. All right? The better you could play church, all right? We don't want that spirit over here. All right? We're not playing church over here. We all got our ups and downs, our struggles and stuff like that, but we're not playing church over here. You see, that's hypocrisy. You know, don't you dare come here acting like you don't have no struggles and you all that in a bag of chips. And then we read about you in the paper, picking up women by the four corners. Don't you. Don't. I'd rather you just be real. I'd rather you come here and just don't say nothing. Don't try to preach. Don't try to act for no position. Just be real. Pastor, I'm not ready. I got some things. Jesus talked about it all the time. He said there was wolves in sheep's clothing. Hypocrisy. He says, not everybody that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. He was always talking about it. In Matthew 6, he dedicated almost the whole chapter to it. He says, take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father in heaven. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee as the hypocrites do. You want to appear a certain way. That's why some people have asked me, listen, you could raise a whole bunch of money in Philly, Pastor. You could raise a whole bunch of money and you can finish off this project. Listen, we got a plan. All you got to do is do a $20 line, a $50 line, a $100 line, and a $1,000 line. I ain't do no line up in here. This ain't Soul Train. This ain't a line. Well, number one, God said, listen, your almsgiving should be in secret. But everybody going to know what you're giving, amen, predicated on which line you jump in. So that's contrary to scripture. That's number one. We're not going to be putting little lines in here. All right? The second thing is this. All right? Here's the second thing. People will get up and give. All right? Money that they don't have. You know, now, I'm not talking about the tithe. Go ahead, give your tithe. But they're going to get up and give money they don't have. And they're going to give money just to get in that line so everybody can see them in that line. This is how church work, big brother. You know what I'm saying? Now, some of them write hot checks just to get in the line. Don't even have the $1,000, but going to jump in there and you call them. Well, Pastor, what happened was. But they just want to get in the line. Listen, we want to grow you up in here. We don't want you to give to look a certain way to men. We want you to give to God here. All right? No $1,000 line, no $500 line, no $100 line, no lines. All right? Because we would be putting on a church an Ananias spirit. A giving to show out. We're not doing that. I want you to serve God and not man. I want you to put it in that for God. No ulterior motives. You see, because if you're giving for man, if you're sounding the trumpet, then the Bible says you have your reward. You know how many people meet me in secret? Listen, two people this week met me in secret and wrote me checks for thousands of dollars. I'm talking about 2001, not only 2000. And they, listen, they're not coming up, I have a $2,000 check. But they meet me on the side. He just, look, don't say my name. Just, you understand what I'm saying? Just, you know, hit, just. See, that's when you're giving it to God, man. You ain't worried about, you know what I'm saying? Blowing a trumpet. And now, when you give like that, when you're giving, what the Bible say, giving secret? Woo, when nobody know. Now, of course, I'm going to know I'm the pastor, all right? All right? I'm going to know because I'm starting to want to know that now. Because it's I'm relating it more to your spiritual walk and your maturity. And so like a doctor check your vitals, I'm going to check your vitals. Not only your prayer, your reading, but also your giving. Because that's your vitals. All right? Worship, giving, praying. That's it's vitals. And so I'm going to get involved in that. You know? But you can't be sounding that for the rest of the body to know. That's what Ananias was doing. Come on, give God some glory for that. Amen. All right. We want to seem to be generous when we are really not. You see? We got to do our best to stay away from this hypocrisy. Now, let me show you some other sins that Ananias was guilty of, some other things that attached itself to hypocrisy. And we formulating this sermon, amen, based upon hypocrisy and generosity. But remember, hypocrisy is something that can run throughout your life in any way. In fact, we all have an area in our lives where we are a little bit hypocritical. It's usually associated with your besetting sin. Where you hide it so nobody can see it. And some even pretend not to have it. It's hypocritical. And I'm telling you, man, I'm going to move on, yeah, but sometimes I watch on TV pastors and Christians get on there and they argue and they fuss at people in a lifestyle that they themselves partake in. That boy mad at homosexuals while he touching little boys. And I'm not justifying that. Now, that's sin. But don't you dare. You know what I'm saying? Judge the speck that's in your brother's eye when you got a log in your eye. That's hypocritical. Get yourself right. Then you can look at it and say, that's not right. Why I can say it's not right? Because I ain't doing that. That's why I can say that. Come on, let's move on. Let's move on. God help us not to be hypocrites. The funny thing about it is that our children can tell when we being hypocritical. Children know when their parents are hypocrites. If I had to bring them up, they could tell us the date, the time, and the particular sin that their parents hypocritical. Not only children, but your lost family and friends. Come on, we gotta move on, y'all. Come on, come on now. You know what I'm saying? Man, that's why humility is so important. Baby Christians don't have humility. Because they don't know how hypocritical they are yet. All right, let me give you the sins that's associated with it. B. What else was Ananias doing? He was practicing lying and deceit. All right? Because anytime you acting like something that is not, you know, it's a lie, you know. We got to be careful with lying because we say, well, I never told them that. And, you know, but sometimes we can do things to make people believe things. And that's what we call deception, all right? It don't have to come out your mouth. And you don't have to tell them. But when you do things to lead them into that, all right? I don't have to take your hand and walk you down the trail. But if I put obstacles and obstructions to the point to where you can't get any other place but in that trail, I have effectively led you without grabbing your hand. But because, you see what I'm saying? So we got people that lie, but they well, I never said that. No, but you led them to believe that. And that's Ananias. And, you know, we don't want deception. We don't want deception. All right? The Bible tells us where deception and lying comes from. And it comes from the enemy. He's a deceiver. John 8 talks about him being the father of lies. All right, meaning that every lie that's told comes from him. But we're gonna talk about that in a little bit deeper here in a second. So Ananias was practicing deception; he was lying, and we see it in the text, Miss Denise, because Peter he talked about it over and over again in our text. He said, "You have not lied unto men; you lied to the Holy Ghost. You lied unto God. Why had Satan filled that heart to lie? It was a lie that he was practicing. Some people can't see. Did Ananias do wrong? Yeah, he did wrong. He was a hypocrite, and he was practicing deceit and lies. Number three, selfish ambition. This was another fallacy of Ananias' actions, all right? Selfish ambition. Selfish ambition, remember, it's all about lifting yourself up. It's all about self-promotion. It's not about the glory of God. He didn't give it to glorify God. He gave it to lift himself up, to raise himself in position in church. We see Barnabas giving, right? And Barnabas like kind of blew up. He gives. He's taking in new Christians. He's starting new works. He's on a path of prosperity and promotion in the church. And a lot of times, you being a Christian, you could see people being promoted, amen, and say, I want to be up there. I want to be promoted. And I'm going to do what I got to do to get it. And sometimes it's a selfish ambition, you know. It's a pride. You just want to be in the lights, you know. Ananias was like that. He desired, amen, spiritual promotion. He desired spiritual status. You know how in the world we desire status? Them to call them Mr. and Mrs. and doctor and this and that. And with the neighborhood we live in. Listen to me now, new Christians. There is such a thing called spiritual status in the church. Where we want to rise up. And it's just, it's a selfish ambition that's not for the glory of God. And it was sin. What else was Ananias doing wrong? Well, he loved the praise of men. He wanted so much for people to stand up and applaud him that he lied to God for it. I could see him standing up at church one Sunday. After Barnabas gave the money for the land, he stood up after he saw people applauding and giving glory to God for Barnabas. And, you know, and you got to see that selfish ambition. It's something on the inside of you that cringes when somebody else get applause. It's a jealousy. You know, it's a jealousy. is so strong you could be jealous of your own children, your spouse, your 12 group leader, even your own pastor. It's just this thing like, you know, why they up there? And why is that? Why? And it's just, And so there he goes. He's in the audience, and they applaud Barnabas. And so he stands up after the applause. He says, everybody, I'm going to give all of the land that I sell on 12th Street in Persia. I don't know. And everybody, oh, ooh. And so he comes and he lays down some money. And everybody stand up and clap and praise a man. He's just like Barnabas, y'all. That's what everybody's saying. He's just as good as Barnabas. The God has raised up another one just as good or even better than Barnabas. But what appears on the surface is not always what it is. What you mean, Pastor? You're going to have two Christians standing up that look the exact same, doing the same works. You see, both Cain and Abel gave sacrifices and all. We could have two people standing here and you look at, and listen, I'm going to teach you something. If you don't have discernment, you looking and you just looking on the outward and the natural. You can't see all the other things that's happening. All right? And you look, oh, they just as good as. Man, I'm going to teach y'all something this morning, man. Man, I'm telling you, man. Wait, it's coming. Listen. He loved the praise of men. I wish I had time. Matthew 6 talks about it. Amen. Hallelujah. Boy. I thought it was 10:30 for a second. Y'all mean to tell me it's 9:30? Oh, y'all in for it. What a time change. Sun stands still over the valley of Adullam. Yeah. Well, let me put up that Matthew 6:5 for you since we got time. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites. For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. To be seen of men. And Ananias came, he gave it to be seen of men. You have no idea how many people do things to be seen of men. When people first come to prayer, amen, I try my best to teach them what we call vertical praying and not horizontal praying. Horizontal praying is when we are praying to the people. And we're trying to use cliches and say words and scripture to get people to clap. And after they clap, after we pray, we feel like we have achieved it. That's the new believer's prayer. But let me show you a more excellent way this morning. You're going to get to a place when you're not praying for people. You know what I'm saying? Number one, you're going to pray when you have prayer. All right, that's number one. You ain't going to be praying all the time and nobody else can get prayer. You're going to pray when you have prayer. All right? Then when you pray when you have prayer, you don't care who listening. You don't care who that. You're not for the praise of men. You're praying straight to God. You learn the lesson this morning. Learn how to search your heart and ask yourself, am I doing this to be seen, for attention. So somebody might think, oh, how great she is, how great he is. God says those prayers, those offerings and gifts, he looks at that when it come up and he says, I'm not going to answer that. Because they got what they wanted already. They wanted people to clap, and so they got that. I'm not answering that. All right? Me and Brother Carl been doing this a long time. And we didn't have many people come in prayer, and you know what I'm saying? They won't try to set the block on fire. But when you have discernment, you can tell who they praying to. Discernment, hallelujah. Discernment can tell the direction of the voice. It can tell where it's going. You can tell where it's going. You know? Somebody say, Lord, give me discernment. The person who taught us the prayer model at Philadelphia, Apostle Wooten, would stop people when they prayed like that. That's where I got the bell from. And y'all think I'm rough because I ring y'all because y'all pray too long. He would stop y'all. He would say, steady in the spirit. That's not for us. Steady. Maybe our prayer group gonna get to that point where you gonna allow me when I discern it to say, Now, nobody going to pray Thursday. Watch. They're going to be like, you pray. But what I'm finding is, and I'm a little upset about it. Can I be real with y'all for a second? Since we have time. I'm coming to prayer, and I'm hearing a lot of the younger Christians pray. And the intercessors who built the ministry of prayer at Philadelphia sit in the back. That's the first problem. Sit in the back and don't pray. And sometimes I leave prayer vexed. Because for about 20 minutes, we wasting time because them babies don't even know what to ask for. And the ones really that can do it, Brother Carl, they sitting back and ain't saying nothing. First, they sitting way in the back. They sitting on the camera stand back there. Come to the front, man. That's why people are hollering over you, because you're way in the back. You in the fall, you're trying to pray in here. And if I hear you praying, I will stop the babies and give you the green light to pray. That's how much respect I got for the intercessors that's been with us. Because I know, Miss Karen, that y'all know vertical prayer. Can I pastor y'all here for a second? Since we got time. All right, okay, let's keep going. Remember, the school of prayer is a school. And the baby's never going to learn if the elders don't show them. Listen to me. He loved the praise of men. Let me tell you something else that Ananias had a problem with. He loved money. Some people call it greed, covetousness. Another word for it would be avarice. But he loved money, is what it is. Now, here's the deal, Jen. Or Miss Harvey, as they call you at school. He loved the praise of men so much, Maisha, he loved it so much, that he was going to give money for it. But not all the money. Because he loved his money too. He couldn't do like Barnabas was to lay it all down. Now he had a covetous problem. So when he said he was going to give it all, he didn't even do what he said he was going to do because he had loved his money so much. I wonder how many in here done made a vow to God, done told God, God, I'm a tithe, I'm a... But that love of that l'argent, that love of that money, got you being an Ananias and holding back that part you promised God that you would give. And sometimes it's because of this. Listen, just that love of that money. You want it in your pocket. And you like certain things, amen, at your house. And hallelujah, you're going to let the house of God come to disrepair. But that avarice, nature, that covetousness, you know, will keep you from fulfilling your promise. Let me give you another one. He doubted God. He doubted God. You see, Pastor, that's a whole sermon. In some churches it would be. But that's just my first point, y'all. He doubted God. What you mean by that? Well, whenever you don't give what God tells you to give, or you don't give what you promised God that you would give, one of the main issues that you have is unbelief. See, when you don't give a tenth, when you don't give what you promised God, you are saying, God, I need to keep this because I won't be able to take care of myself. So you right then and there, you've doubted God. Because God has said, listen, give and it shall be given to you, pressed down, shaken together, running over. You have doubted that scripture. All right? You doubted God saying to you, listen, I take care of the birds of the air, the lilies of the field, I clothe, amen. I feed them all, amen. But you say, God, I got to take care of myself so I can't get this $50. Because this $50 is standing between me and my light bill or me and my mortgage, and God's standing up there laughing. You think that's all that's standing between you and the street? No, I'm standing between you and the street. When he went up there, minister, and he gave part, it was unbelief. And anything that's not of faith is sin, the Bible says. All right? Unbelief. He didn't tithe. He didn't give what he promised because he didn't believe the promises of God. Y'all got that one? Can I stop or shall I go on? Who in here don't believe God? You're still not giving what God told you to give. And here you are thinking that you keeping everything afloat. You have an illusion of power. It's doubt. Somebody say, Lord, help my unbelief. The tither is somebody that operates in faith. You saw something in the spirit. The farmer takes his seed and puts it away from his eyes. He is told that if he plants this seed and waters it, that it will grow. Now, he can't see it growing, Patrice. But by faith, he know he's done what he has to do. And by faith, he can't see it. Faith is the evidence of things hoped for. Oh, come on now. The substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. He can't see it. But under the ground is growing. The sower has faith. The farmer has faith. Those that don't sow and don't plant don't have faith. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. All right. Let's move on to point number two. Yeah. But Peter said, I'm going to give y'all a whole word this morning. A whole. Y'all want a whole word this morning? All right. But Peter said, Acts 5 and 3. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and kept back part of the price of the land. The Bible says, but Peter said. Once again, the conjunction, but. It means, remember, to the contrary, in opposition, in contrast. So what are you talking about, Pastor? Well, Ananias has just fooled the whole church. Everybody's believing that he's something that he's not. Oh, he's just as holy as Barnabas. He's just as great as Peter. He's just as awesome as Paul. And everybody's in an uproar, but Peter. The conjunction. But Peter. But Peter. Right? Just when everyone else was fooled, Peter, with discernment, saw straight through hypocrisy. Remember, hypocrisy is a mask. Now, what we need to combat the hypocrite is the spiritual gift, discernment. Somebody say, Lord, give me discernment. Put it on your prayer list. Pray for it tomorrow. Pray for it tonight. Pray for it all week. Pray for it all the rest of the year. In 2017 come, start off praying for discernment. When we go on our 21-day fast, let that be one of the things that you ask the Lord. Lord, give me discernment. That's one of the greatest things that we need right now in the church is discernment. A hypocrite can be right by a Christian. Christian, never know. No discernment. No discernment. In the age of deception, there will be almost no greater gift than discernment. To be able to pierce past the silhouette, the surface, the thing that they want us to see. There is present discernment. There is historical discernment. There is individual discernment. There is church discernment. There is not only local church discernment to see how the church is going, the whole people know what's going on in the church. There is also the universal church to know what the church as a whole and where it's going and what's happening and what's going on, what time we living in. Oh, God have mercy. There is national discernment. To know where we are as a nation and as it relates to history and political and what's going on in the day we living in. Where you at? Where you at? Let me start you off. You gonna need discernment, amen. Let me start you off. You're going to need discernment with your children. Let's just start off at the basics. Because if you can't see what your children doing, how you going to know what the whole church going through? How you going to know what's going on in the body of Christ? God, give me discernment in the lives of my children. So that, listen. Peter had no outside information. You hear, Parker? He didn't know anything. He wasn't at the cash sale, the exchange of the home. He didn't hear anything. And Ananias come like everybody else, laid on the altar. Peter said, with no outside information. Now watch me, Miss Mary. Watch me. Them children done did something wrong. With no outside information. Nobody told you nothing like that. You just look at you say, something ain't right about that. Where you was, what you did, how was you did it. We're going to get to it. Hold on, wait. We're going to search all over. Because something ain't right. Then the mind water up. Daddy. Ain't nothing a child hate worse than a parent with discernment. Somebody that could just look at him. He looking back, boy. All right, all right. Somebody that could just look at him. They don't even like to look in the eyes of discernment. And if you think, you know, a parent is bad with discernment, the Bible talks about Christ. His eyes are a flame of fire. Dude looking at you, boy, look. Everything come my Lord, when I was six, I took something. I'm sorry. I was hungry that day. Thank you for finding my remote in the parking lot the other day, Mr. Warren. You're a blessing, Mr. Warren. So, discernment. You need it with your children. Pray for it heavily. You can keep them out of so much trouble. You're going to be able to know what's going on. You know, since we're not perfect, of course, some things are going to happen that we don't know. All right? But you want to do the best you can. All right? Here's another one. You need discernment with your spouse. We got some people, they don't even look at their wife. They don't even look at their husband. They don't know what's going on. You need discernment with your spouse. Come see my baby. What'd you say? Interesting. Yeah. I can discern that she don't want to be up here. Put you back to my back. All right? This is what discernment looked like. I got her back, she got mine. You know what I'm saying? All right? That's what discernment looked like. You see? Because a discerning wife gonna look at that husband and say, you know what I'm saying? You okay? You being tempted? What's going on with you? Your prayers ain't been the same. You ain't been reading. You know what I'm saying? Your face is not the same. It's oh, thank you, baby. You did so well. Are you discerning for your spouse? Checking their spiritual vitals and seeing what's going on inside of them. Piercing through was, I'm getting mail. You know, there's a spouse praying for the spouse to have some discernment. To just look at me, I'm hearing. Just look at me. Just look at me. That's what that spouse is praying. Just look at me. Can you hear me? Can you feel me? Can you read me? Can you see what I'm going through? Or is life all about you? Discernment is about attention. That's what it's about. People that don't pay attention don't have discernment. Because to have discernment, you got to pay attention. That's why some of the quietest ones be having some of the most. You know what I'm saying? Just sitting there watching. Are you talking too much? Are you moving too fast? You see, because what was that sign they had on your room door, baby? Oh, yeah. No, it wasn't for you, but I'm just saying. When she was small, they put a little sign on her, and she got it now because she's pretty quiet. She's, you know, such a prudent wife. The signs say, you're not listening if you're talking. All right? And discernment is. So look, if we're praying for discernment, here it is. You got to begin watching again. You got to begin listening again. You got to stop moving so fast all the time. Amen. And just look at your kids. Look at your spouse. Amen. Look beyond the surface of it. Discernment is going to be a great asset as you raise your children. Very seldom, amen, you're going to be caught off guard by something because you will see it coming. You will see it coming. You will see it in them while the package is on the way. And you will be able to intercept what the devil is planning for your children. You say, I know, devil. I see you. All right? Now, when you get to another level, you want to be able to have discernment for your kids, for your spouse, okay? For the whole ministry that you're over. You're 12. You want to look at your people with discernment. What is going on with your ministry, ushers, you know, nursery? What is, how you gonna work nursery and put people in care of our kids with no discernment? You're a ministry, you're not even looking at them. You letting anybody in your ministry, there's no question about. And me and Deli talk about that all the time. How are we going to just let somebody jump on security without no discernment? Your kids, your spouse, your ministries, you're going to take you up to discern the church. Where's the spirit? How is the devil attacking Philly? Let me give you a little hint of discernment. He attacking marriages right now. Can you feel him? Can you see him? Or are you only just worried about yours? See, when you raise up, and you could see which door he's trying to get in. All right? But he attacking marriage and your marriage on the rocks and you having trouble, but you wasn't at the marriage night, friend. Well, I'm tripping up. I didn't even want to trip like that. So you're going to discern for the church. Then he's going to give you discernment for the body of Christ. Christendom, how does it look right now in comparison when our Lord gave birth to it on Calvary, comparing it with the church of Acts, the church of Martin Luther, John Calvin? Where are we in the church? Are we stronger, weaker? Where's the word at? Where's prayer at? Where's giving at? Where's holiness at? Are our marriages sound? Then there's a historical discernment. Because lies are just not today. They lied yesterday. Woo! Right. Boy, that boy tripping. Yeah! Can you still see a lie that happened 100 years ago? 200 years ago? 300 years ago? 400 years ago? Do you have enough discernment to read it, to look at it, to study it, and say that don't add up to this, and this don't mix up, and that don't match? And all I gotta say is, after putting discernment on it, they not the people, we the people. I'm cutting up. You doubt me, and you can't see your kids, and you're mad, and your wife. But Peter said, the Holy Ghost. Everybody else fooled. Peter said, Ananias. Huh? In the midst of all the applause, huh? Why had Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? You see? Peter V. reveals to Ananias what we would call the source of his sin. Let's put that up there, the source of his sin. Now, don't get all theologically technical with me, because we know that when we are led away, we are usually led away with our own lust. But there is oftentimes an ignition, a catalyst. And in the same text, James says we're led away by our own lust when we are enticed. That's an outside agent enticing us, pulling us, putting the carrot down, putting the rice bran, putting the corn out there, amen, trying to get you to be to a place that'll cause you harm. The source of Ananias' sin, Peter reveals, is Satan. We can corroborate that through scripture because the same Bible says that he is the father of lies. Everybody who lied, borrow that lie straight from the lips of the devil. Every lie come from him. Why had Satan filled thine heart? I love that. Fill thine heart. Do you know that Satan wants to fill your heart? He wants to fill your heart. Why does he want to fill your heart? If he fill your heart, he can control your life. We have to guard our heart, for out of it comes the issues of life. We live from this thing. If he gets your heart, he has your life. He ain't got to try to mess you up. Individual decisions, he has the root already. How does Satan fill our hearts? Oh, let me reveal him to you this morning. Y'all not tired yet, huh? Y'all tired already? Come on now, we gave y'all an extra hour of sleep up in here. How does Satan fill our hearts? Woo! One of the prophetess said in prayer, you know. She said, through our ears and through our eyes. That's the doorway to the soul. And so when people talking to us, music we listen to, things that's going on, it's filling our heart up. Things we see is filling our heart up. But there's another way I'm going to reveal to you. Satan fills our heart also through our mind. He does not have direct access to your heart. He got to fill it through the ears, through the eyes. He can't just get in there. He has to use a highway, a means. It's almost like God then put a boundary around it, a border. But he got to go through different means and mechanisms to get something in that heart. That's why God says you have to guard it. And he wouldn't tell you to guard it if you didn't have the capability to guard it. You can guard it. Watch what you hear. Watch what you see. Hey, God, I'm about to show you another way. All right? All right? All right? Yeah, because he's after that heart. If he fills your heart with perversion, you will be a perverse person. If he fills your heart with thoughts on addiction, drugs, you're going to be a drug user. If he fills your heart with adultery, you're going to be an adulterer. If he fills your heart with greed and money and things, hey, God, you're going to be a covetous person, a drug dealer, and wind up selling your body, because the love of money is the root of all evil. There's nothing. It's about filling your heart if he can get it. What you watching? What you listening to? That's why I don't watch and listen to anything. I don't watch. I don't listen to just know anything. Because you think he after just entertaining you. When he really after your heart. And the funny thing is, we think that we can stop something. Once it gets in here and gets in here, we think we can stop. It's all downhill from here, baby. It's going to be some things that you can do afterwards to help get it out of there. How shall a cleanse his way by taking heed according to that word there. That word cleansed that heart, the things that we got in it inadvertently. Let me share with you. Come on. Let me share with you this way. Now, here it is. The ears, the eyes. Let me show you another way that Satan will fill your heart. He will attack your mind. He will attack your mind. And in the day that we're living in here today, I'm about to drop you something that's rhema. Because just like the assaults on our ears and our eyes have gone up exponentially, attack on the human mind is beyond cognitive recognition. He is fighting and playing mind games incessantly. And if you don't watch yourself, that devil will take your mind and drive you crazy, break you down. Come on, somebody. He's trying to control what you think. Ephesians 6 talks about one of the weapons in his arsenal. It talks about what we call fiery darts. I want you to imagine an archer, somebody with a bow, a crossbow, whatever particular modification of a weapon that you would desire to imagine, you can. But it should have a string and an arrow, all right? If it's a crossbow, if it's a bow and arrow, amen. Satan and his legions, his minions, they have them. Right? It's not just Cupid with the little diaper on got bows. Shooting people with love. The devil not shooting people with love. He's shooting them with hate and unforgiveness and bitterness and lust and addiction and bondage. But the Bible says he just don't shoot darts. That would be an arrow. It's called a fiery arrow. You see, back in the medieval days, the bow and arrow was like, man, it was like a tactical weapon of choice. You would have no army, amen, without what we would call the archers, amen. And usually they were the first to engage an enemy army, amen. Before the armies even come and do hand battle with the infantry, the archers are standing on the wall or positioned on a hilltop, and as the armies are approaching each other, they're raining down a hail of arrows. Can I tell you that we are in a war? And that the weapons that we fighting against and the weapons of our warfare, listen, the devil minions, while you going to work and do your thing, there is a cloud of arrows coming at you. There is a cloud of arrows. Back in the day when they used to fight, the arrows would be so plenteous in the sky that when they would shoot, the sun would go dark. But there was something even more deadly than just a regular arrow. Something that we call the fiery arrow. You take the tip of that arrow and you wrap it in some type of fabric. And then you put it in like a tar or what they would call a pitch, but something that was flammable, almost like a So, but you know what I'm saying? Even thicker than that. But when you would light it, amen, it would survive the trajectory. Stay on fire, hit the target. The petroleum substance, amen, would splash itself on the target. All right? The arrow would pierce. If the arrow didn't kill you, the petroleum substance that spread upon, I don't mean to touch you like that, but I'm just saying, you know. It was spread upon you, and if the arrow didn't kill you, the fire will consume you. Take that time with spiritual warfare. You have a weakness, a place in your armor where you're not that strong. That devil takes his arrow. Let that demon light it on the side. Put it up, shoot it, hit you. What does that look like? A thought. She's cheating. He's cheating. Your weakness of trust. You don't trust because of all the dirt you done did. You know what I'm saying? Now, that's the way the devil works. Now, he done got you to do all that dirt. Now, you're thieving. You don't do that dirt no more, but he's going to use your own dirt against you and say that she doing you like you was doing everybody else. And now, woo, he done hit you with an arrow. All right? Now, hallelujah, the best thing to do, hallelujah, when you're a Christian, amen, is to get that arrow out of there as quick as you can. Grab that thing and throw that thing as far as you can. All right? But not all of us do that. We don't fight the battle of the mind. He's cheating. Where is he? He's, and that thing go in there. And we walk around the house all day with that thing in us. Just burning. That thing just burning and it is consuming us. And what's actually happening is it's consuming your thoughts. You're going through everything she said, everything he said. You're checking their phone, you're doing all that, and you're doing all that, and you, yeah, she was there, she was there. And it's things that never even happened and not even real. But it doesn't consume you. And it's not just with mistrust, amen. It's with anything when somebody do you wrong. They done did you wrong, and now you're offended, and that devil's sitting outside your house right on Third Street looking at you. Look. And he hit you with that thing. And now you go thinking about, I can't believe she did that. And that fire you spread, and I can't believe it, man. I all the stuff I did for her, and if he would have just been, and I'm just, and you just talking to yourself, washing them dishes up in there, boy, when I get her. And he's consuming that mind, and when that mind gets consumed, when you get so heavy in the mind, when you let that thing, you can't stop a bird from landing on your head, but you can stop it from building a nest. You can't stop the arrow from hitting you. Thoughts are gonna come, but you gotta pull that out and you gotta extinguish that. You gotta drop and roll. You got devil. I'm not thinking about that. All right. Because when you fill that mind up with all that stuff, that just imagine, that mind is like a sponge, and all of that, all those thoughts, and it just don't stay in your mind. It actually sinks down. Where are we going now? It actually sinks down in your heart. And he done fill your heart. Now you got a root of bitterness. And every relationship from here on out is going to be damaged and messed up, because it's not in your mind no more. No, it's in your heart. It's affecting you live, for out of the heart flows the issues of life. You can't help but to live out of it, and now you're wounded. You got this place in your heart that this devil done. Hallelujah. Why hast thou allowed Satan to fill thine heart? You gotta learn to fight that battle, the battle of the mind. Peter said, gird up the loins of your mind, tighten your mind up, don't let anything in it. Don't think about anything. Gird up the loins of your mind. Tighten it up. Tighten it up. Devil, I'm not thinking about it. I don't care how she looked. I don't care what she got on. I'm not thinking about it. Because he's trying to consume you. Gird it up. Philippians says, hallelujah, hallelujah. You want to think on some things? Philippians 4:8, think on these things, he said. If it be true, honest, pure. What Paul was saying is you got to put a filter on that mind. Don't just let that mind go anywhere it want to go, do anything it want to do. That's how the devil gets you. And now I saw the sell price. Ooh, boy. Daddy sure need a pair of brand new shoes. And we could do this with that and that with this and that. And that's just them dark. He walk out that room back full of arrows. Sunk in his heart, we keeping the money. You see? And listen to me. Listen to me now. Let me go deeper. I hate to go deep because y'all might not believe me. The devil has become so potent in the days that we are living in. where the spiritual battle is not just merely spiritual no more. He has elicited to his aid whole nations and people groups and corporations and companies and inventions. It's a tremendous juggernaut of a Luciferian socio-political system that is worldwide. He knows what he do to us on the inside. And he allowed companies to accentuate those things. And, you know, he know a man get thoughts of lust, but he creates HBO and Showtime. Come out the spiritual into the natural. It's just not one arrow he's shooting. It's the arrows coming from everywhere, billboards. And the dude that got a trouble with drink, you know what I'm saying? The bottle sweating on the billboard wet. Let me tell you something now. Some of the medicines we take, some of the medicines we take over the counter or prescription were created to amplify the battle of the mind. To make the voices louder, the thoughts stronger. And listen, you know, just discernment and talk. I went through a little bout, and I'm just taking something for allergies. But I'm spiritual. I'm real sensitive, and all of a sudden I'm like, what's going on? And the Lord dropped it on me. Look what the Lord told me. The Lord said, stop taking that. I said, Lord, but my sons. The Lord said, stop taking that. You moody? You want to fuss with everybody? You cutting up? Got your wife saying, what's wrong with you, boy? Look, the one I'm telling, the Lord said, stop taking that. I said, Lord, I just bought that. That ain't no legal or no illegal. Said, Lord, that's just over the counter medicine. The Lord said, but you don't know the battle, babe. Oh, look. I never take it again. And look, stop taking that, look. I don't know why I said that. But maybe somebody arguing. Check what you're taking. Check what you're taking. All right? The devil done learned how to teach men how to put things in medication that open doors in the mind. They don't just have to shoot an arrow into it. They could drive a through it after you take. You hear me, going? Oh, Pastor went crazy. I ain't never went no crazy. All right, listen. We got the Lord's Supper. All right, the Bible tells us. That's why he say. Casting down every imagination that exalts itself against the knowledge of God in Christ Jesus. It's this battle that I don't want that thought in my head. You know? All right? He showed us the source of sin. Quickly, y'all. Quickly. He showed us the responsibility for sin. Now, isn't that something? That the devil can shoot the dart, ignite us, initiate, all right? It's not even something that's really that we trying to pursue. He got it all started, but guess who's going to be responsible for it? Got a lot of people saying, oh, the devil made me do it. I, you know what I'm saying? I hear you. You know? But not only will the devil get his, you're going to get yours too. All right? So the devil, look, I'm going to try to make it quick. The devil filled his heart, but he was the one that opened his mouth and lied. All right? The devil told him to keep some of the money, but he was the one who actually went up to the altar and laid back a portion of it. Right? Let me tell you something right here. The devil can't make you do nothing. All right? He can tempt you, and he can push you, and if you just sit there and allow him, oh, yeah, he's going to fill your heart up. You sitting in front of that TV, that computer, you just sitting in the midst of that car, he's going to fill your heart. But at the end of the day, he can't make you do anything. He can't make you do nothing. That's why when you sin, the onus lies on you. The responsibility lies with you. Yeah, you was tempted. Ananias was tempted, but he took part of the money. And we're going to watch God deal with him. No, devil going to get his later. But you just got to watch yourself that you don't get some of that too. Come on, give God some glory, amen? All right? Oh, look, I got one. The seriousness of our sin. That's what we learned from Peter's discernment. The source, why had Satan, hallelujah, got you to lie to the Holy Spirit, the responsibility of our sin. He lied. The seriousness of our sin. He says, you had not lied unto men, but you lied to the Holy Ghost, to God. Lord, put something on my heart here. People like Ananias come into the house of God, into the kingdom of the Most High, amongst the people of the Ancient of Days. And they take this place, this holy congregation, this assembly, they treat it as though it were a Kiwanis meeting, or a fraternity, or a sorority. And they come in with the same mindset, with the same argumentative spirit, with the same lying, the same fussing, the same cussing, the same sleeping around, the same adulterous ways, the same, all that stuff. They bring that into this congregation thinking that we are just some big social club. Like somehow we outside again. Are we the school you used to go to? Or this is Southern or UL. Oh, you done mistaken some things here. This is not a fraternity. It's not a sorority. It's not a social club. This is the church of the living God. This is the kingdom of the Most High. His people and the sheep of his pasture. And Ananias thought that he could get away within the church, what he was getting away with in the world. You have not lied to men. We got some in here playing games. You think this is a social club? You talking about people? You gossiping? You trying to mess with somebody's husband or trying to mess with somebody's wife? You better see what Peter told Ananias now. You better fear God. You better not play with God. I understand that your other church, they were doing all this. That wasn't even a church. That was a social club. Don't bring that over here. Don't bring that over here. Don't bring that over here. Listen. Don't bring that over here because God's going to deal with you. I always told people if I wanted to cut up, I'd still be in the world. Why in the world, my issue, we going to come to church and cut up? Huh? And cut up halfway? I ain't cut up halfway. I cut up all the way. I'd still be in the world if I wanted to cut up. But they come here. I won't cut up in the church. Now, in the world, I ain't never even knew him, never even saw him. Wouldn't even cut up that much, cutting up this much in the world. Won't come cut up in the church. Won't come cut up in the church. Man, aren't you afraid of the Most High God? Listen, man. Woo! In Revelations 1:13, he said, John said, I saw somebody. Feet like bronze. Hair like wool. Eyes a flame of fire. Round his waist was a golden girdle. John, where you saw him, he was walking in the midst of the candlesticks. Well, John, what's the candlesticks? John said, I saw seven candlesticks. And the seven candlesticks were the churches. You come here to pray, but the God of the universe is walking amongst his church. He's right there. He's in the aisles. He's taking care of everything. He's not far away. He's in the midst of the candlesticks. He's right there. You have not lied to man. You've lied to the Holy Ghost. You have not cheated on somebody in the street. You cheated on the house of God. You have not come here and gossiped and cussed and talked about somebody out there in VZ. You talked about the people that's in the house of the living God yet. Hey, God have mercy. I don't understand it. Come here and do wrong to one another. Come here and do wrong to leaders and ministers and deacons and your very own pastor yourself. And can't make the correlation. Can't see why things going wrong in your life. Can't see why the bottom done fell out. Can't see why this don't work and that don't work. You done put your mouth on the people of God. And God said, whatsoever you do to the least of these, my brother, you've done it unto me. Listen to me. It's a seriousness. But listen. I'm telling you. If I made a list of them all. And you know how they do that? Where are they now? If I made a list of them all. And Doug, I don't say nothing on Doug. Doug, listen, I don't say nothing. But I hear what happens to him. Oh, yeah, I hear about it. I don't say nothing. I ain't saying nothing. You don't rejoice when some, you don't do that. I pray for him, Lord. Send them back. Bless them. Keep them, Lord. Why are some of y'all playing? Amen. Look. As I stand before you right now, look at me good. Take it as a warning. Discernment. We're coming into a time of judgment. Judgment. And judgment, if it's going to start, judgment has to start in the house of God. Get your house in order. Stop playing games. Don't be doing that type of stuff amongst this place. It's a time. It's crush time right now. Do you know what time it is? You have not lied to men. This ain't your fraternity. It's not your sorority. This is not Kiwanis. Let's wrap this up. Third and final point quickly. I got my extra hour. I really use it. Hearing these words. Put that scripture up there for me. We're going to do this quick. We got some work to do up in here in a second. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. He died. We don't know if it was a heart attack, a stroke, aneurysm? Yeah. That. Aneurysm, yeah. We don't know what it is, but don't miss the forest looking for the trees. It wasn't the issue that killed him, it was God that killed him. Yeah, I said it. God killed him. Bad doctrine. God don't hurt nobody. That's bad doctrine. God don't hurt nobody? What happened to Uzzah? Come on. When he touched the ark? What happened to Lot's wife when she looked back? What happened to Achan when he stole the wedge of gold and the Babylonian garments? Who did that? Who ordered that? What happened to Sodom and Gomorrah? What happened during the Noah flood when he destroyed every living, breathing thing? And God do that, my brothers and sisters, to show the seriousness of what it is to play with him. All right? That's why he do. And we've been in an age of grace, but that time is coming back. The people are back. The age of grace is coming to a close. And he's about to get back to how he used to handle sin and people that played with him. Do you see it in your Bible that there's a change from the New Testament to the book of Revelation? When he opened the seals and the vials and blow the trumpets and began to crank up the wine press of the wrath of Almighty God, and the blood is at the horse's bridle, and sores and grievous sores upon men, everyone who has the mark of the beast and the image of the name. He give us glimpses like that. Don't play with me. Hearing these words, Ananias fell down. He died. You see? He died. There's some people who say that Ananias was saved. You know? I don't know. I'm not God. You know? If Ananias was saved, it teaches us that God will check out his children. Check them out of school. They cutting up so much, get your things, let's go. So for the Christians in here, realize that there is a level where God's going to say, enough. You're not ruining my name no more, messing up your witness no more. If you don't know how to play with everybody else, we going home. Gotta check you out. Gotta check you out the game, boy. I'm telling you, one day you're it and the next you're gone. It's the scariest thing. If Ananias was unsaved, not only did he get checked out, avert, but he got checked in to hell. I'm not telling you the answer to that. The Bible didn't say so. I'm not gonna speculate where he at. Because I see a principle in both of them. See? All right, y'all. I'm back at that time that I wish I wasn't about an hour ago. Got a lot to do. Ushers, come on up, ushers. We're going to do it all. Ushers, come on up. Listen, it's offering time, amen. We're going to give. And then we're going to do something with the altar. Then we're going to have the Lord's Supper. Listen, we're going to do it all. Babe, do you think we could do it all, or you think I should chill? We can do it all? Thank you for your wisdom, woman of God. Oh, yeah, the altar. Y'all don't be embarrassed. Every Sunday I say come and they stop at the thing. Y'all don't want to be close by me. I know you want to be close. I know. Come on. Listen. Let's not be like Ananias this morning. Let's be like Barnabas. Let's not doubt God when we got to come and give him what he asks for. As though God can't take care of our bills. Come and give your offering to the Most High this morning. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. Don't be ashamed. Don't be embarrassed. Come on. If you could stand up in the club, you could stand up in church. Huh? If you could walk to the bar, you could walk to the altar. Huh? Some of y'all ashamed to get up. Come and give that to the Most High this morning. Come and give him an offering, a sweet offering. Not like Cain, but like Abel. Come and give him an offering, worthy, worthy of his name. Hallelujah. We're also going to need the communion people as well to come on up. Just make your way to the altar, the communion workers. We're going to do it all, y'all. My bad, I took a little too long, but I just felt like talking to y'all. All right? Hallelujah. Mel, where your communion workers at, Mel? Oh, y'all doing too? Huh? Lord have mercy. Y'all already here. Migo. Doug. Y'all do what y'all gotta do with these baskets after they give. And we gonna, what's that prayer? And we gonna, oh yeah, I'm good, Migo. You know I'm good. Now you're giving him money. Will you give him your soul? You've given him money. Will you give him your soul? Whether you're saved or not, you know it. I wonder how many Ananiases we have in here. If you're not saved this morning, admit that you're a sinner. Believe in Jesus Christ, his death, burial, resurrection. Open your mouth and confess him. God's going to save you. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But there's some Christians in here. You got to come to me. Come and pray with me. Come on. Come on, Brother Harold. Come on up right here. Come on up on this step, but I have some space. We're going to give him some space. We're going to give him some space. Why had Satan filled thine heart? Why has he? Why have you allowed him to bring you to the place where you are, Christian? Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the seat of sinners, or sitteth in the seat of scorn. You've been letting the devil just play mind games with you. Come to the altar. We're going to put the blood of Jesus on it. We're going to press delete this morning. No weapon formed against you gonna prosper. Pray with me now. Say, Lord, I give myself away so you can use me. I surrender all unto thee, my Savior. I thank you for loving me enough to tell me the truth. I admit I've sinned against you. And I'm sorry. I admit the devil has been playing games with my mind. Lord, I need you right now. I believe that you died on the cross. You were buried in the grave. And on the third day, you rose with all power and all might. I confess you as my Lord and Savior. Lord, I need you. come on down and rescue your child. Get that devil off of me. Take every arrow out of my back, out of my mind. Extinguish the fire that's consuming me. Fix my relationships. Lord, I need you to take my mind back. I want you to talk to that devil right now. I want you to say, devil, enough is enough. By the authority given to me through the cross of Christ, I command you, loose me, let me go. Stop shooting darts at my mind. He who's the Son has set free is free indeed. Lord, show me if I'm taking any medication that's opening doors in my mind. Touch somebody on the side of you. Abba, I got you, my brother. I got you. Y'all don't have to repeat after me no more. I want to just pray for you. Abba, I thank you so much for your people. I thank you for your people. And Father, I see the devil perched on the hilltops and shooting arrows upon your people, God. Father, I raise the shield of faith over them right now, which is able to quench every fiery dart of the adversary. And I pray, oh God, standing in agreement right now, Lord God, that they be free, Lord God, of assault, of molestation, Father God, of any type of attack of the adversary, God. I pray that every fog, every lie, every deception, everything that they believe in that's not real, just a figment of their imagination, God. I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, that you break through the fog right now, that you shine a light. Darkness, God, I pray right now that you go to and rescue those, oh King of Kings. Hey, God, that the devil have feeling alone, God. Suicidal, God, contemplating divorce, God, go to, go in, deliver rescue, God. God, in the name of Jesus, fight for those who fight against us, oh King. Cover your people with the blood of Jesus and let the destroyer pass over. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah! Go ahead and take you one of the little containers. And if you can, return to your seat. We late. But you know, that's Hebrew church. That's just what Hebrew church is. I'm tired of trying to be like all kind of other people. It's sometimes we act like we can't wait on the Lord. Thank you. Sometimes we act like we can't just wait on the Lord. Like we can't wait on the Lord. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Be surprised at the things that we fuss about that's not actually really going on. Mind games. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. got your hope. Let me serve you. Let me serve you. Hallelujah. Thank you. You good? Mike, you got your one? Yeah. It's a deliverance day. On the same night that he was betrayed, he took the bread, he gave thanks, broke it. He said, take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. God, we remember you. We remember you, Jesus, your passion. We repent and ask for forgiveness for not choosing you when we should have. But we choose you now. And we remember now. And we declare that you are the Messiah of the Hebrews this morning. That you are the Savior of the world. We turn back. And as we were standing in front of that platform, we don't cry out Barabbas this morning. We cry out Jesus. We cry out Yeshua. We remember you, Lord. In Jesus' name. The Bible says, in the same way he took the cup after supper, he told him, he said, drink this, drink all of it. This is the New Testament in my blood. Could not get another deal, another way of salvation, but that somebody died for you. Without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission of sins. Lord, we thank you, God, for your blood. In Jesus' name, amen. If you can, just take the cup and pass it down, and our ushers will come by and get them. Amen. Fight, Christians. Fight for your mind. Fight for your mind. Fight for your marriage. Fight for your children. Fight. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you. Bless you with favor. Bless you with peace. Peace in your mind. Peace in your body, peace in your home, peace with your kids, peace on the job, and prosperity. Prosperity. In Jesus' name.
Love you.
Amen. Love y'all. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed.